whole bunch of us have got into biodiversity modelling, because we pretty much figured out fairly quickly, once we started trying to tackle climate change issues, that we'd all done parameters that were weighted averages, and then we'd held them constant through time as the species composition would have changed. So there's a whole bunch of us around the world at the present moment trying to think up smart ways of allowing those parameters to shift through time. So growth rates, consumption rates, potential diet, starting basis to shift through time to represent shifts in diversity. So we're going to play with the model this afternoon that's quite small. Billy is doing a model with, what is it, 10 million squares for the whole of the globe and 22,000 species. He is crazy, basically though, what you do is you get food and you break it down into the proportional makeup. It's always got to be by volume and weight. So one of the easiest mistakes that you get amongst the very early users is they have a beautiful data set because someone has made a penguin throw up and then counted the number of krill, and then they've got one squid and or one big fish in their diet, and that one big fish actually outweighs the 20 krill, but they've done it in numbers, not volume, so it's all back to front. So you have to make sure it's in volume. Some of the other things that you have to think about are the bits that see them flow in and out of the system. So I haven't done it in this case, it's just going to be, there's no outside production, we live in a little closed world if you live in mermaids. But basically you can enter what flows into the system and out of the system, what purposely moves in and out. Or if you've got something that's accumulating. So if you're worried about invasive species, this is one way of putting it in. The slight, you have to be very careful of using this one though. So in the past it's been used where something like a seal or a whale is recovering from having fishing taken off it. The problem is when you go time dynamic, that accumulation continues. So you can't get that group to fall off regardless of what you do to it. So it's okay for invading species, but you have to be really careful about using it for any other situation. The last thing you have to do is you have to say what happens to your detritus. So you can have multiple detritus, you can have multiple pools, so you can have laywild and refractory and discards, and you have to say what's the fate of any dead things, how do they fall out across those. So one trick we often use is to have really freshly dead things, moderately stinky dead things, really, really rotten things, and then, you know, carcasses that won't break down. So, you know, things that break down in order of a couple of days, then a couple of months, then a couple of years, and then a couple of decades and then centuries. So that you've got the different kinds of detritus which aren't as available to the different kinds of animals. But you need to say where it all goes. And you can actually have stuff that gets then shunted out of the system as well. Okay, so that was all the biological side of it. Obviously you've got the human side of it as well. So just as you had to define your animals, you have to define your fleets as well. So we've got the codswallop. So this was out of the book that my kids love about fishing boats. The whippersnapper, which just spends your skin pretty fast to the bite. And then George. I think we've got rid of George, and he's the example you played with. But at that point, my daughter's favourite name is George, and everything got called George. So that. But basically you can say what their cost breakdowns are here, and these default values are pretty much what you see in every eco path model that machine hasn't had anything to do with. So there's no fixed costs, 40% of the effort is a variable cost, and they have 20% profit basically. Most people, of all those thousands of eco path models, most people won't have done economic stuff, but we'll play with it a little bit. And some of Rashid's best stuff has come, or some of Rashid's good stuff that I understand, as opposed to some of the pure economic stuff, which goes, has come from playing. So you shouldn't be negative even though it is. And that only comes from because most of the modelers who play with this are biologists. So that they're not worrying about the human side of things, but it's just as important. Once you've defined your fleets, you need to say how much they catch of each thing. So you have the landings, you say how much they actually land of all the different. And you can notice that they don't have to catch everything, just into what they do. And you also have to say what they throw away. And that's actually, I haven't put a picture on here, but you could have that they actually caught a whole bunch of mermaids, but they threw them back overboard. You put that in the discard form. So it doesn't have to have everything going to land. These are the kinds of data that you need underneath that part, you need your lands and your discards as a bare minimum. Then it's good to have some of these other economic values. There's even the potential to have non-market values. So what that means is ex-vessel prices are what the fishery is getting for that product as it comes off the vessel. So what's it worth in the market? This non-market stuff is actually to cover some existence values, like you just want to have it there to go sailing in or swimming in, or to have some other industry like tourism represented, so that you can have the tension between the different uses of the system represented as well. Again, not too many people do that part, but the potential's there. So if you think about the comment I made earlier today, that lots of these models have lots of options that not everyone uses, that's another example. And you also, much like I had to say where the biological mortality ended up with reefs in terms of the detritus, you need to do that for the discards as well. So this is a discard, oh, that's landing here. So you need for the discard stuff to say where it's ended up. So in this case, I've only got one kind of detritus. But if you're really worried about thinking about bycatch in a fishery, it's good to have a special kind of detritus that's just discards, so that you can definitely track what's coming out of the fishery. So there's some species around the world, shrimp or prawns are one example, and some of the other species that are really popular, like the pink ling in Australia, they actually benefit from there being a fishery. So if you get rid of the fishery, they decline, because they eat their scavengers. So in for a shrimp, you're stirring up the bottom to make it perfect shrimp habitat. For the pink ling, the discards that come back over the other side. The same thing can happen with seabirds. Some of the seabird populations in the UK, for instance, are a bit out of whack because the big scavenging seabirds have dominated because of the trawler discards. But if the trawler discards aren't there, then they turn it into a little seabird. So it's not it's always a simple measure of the big population. Okay, so in the market prices stuff, you can say what they're worth, but biomass, so it could be per kilo or per tonne, what they're coming on, so this will happen to be in euros, it can be whatever unit of currency you want. And then once you've done all that, you've entered all your data in, and then there used to be a special balance button. These days you just click to a different spreadsheet, and it goes and solves the simultaneous equations for you. And more often than not, you get a message saying, this doesn't balance, go back and try again. Your EE is greater than 1. So you're trying to use more than you produce in the system. So you can see over here that for the wise mermaids, we started off with an heterotrophic efficiency of 6, close to 6. What we're trying to do in this particular instance was we're trying to use 6 times what was produced. Yep?
And so obviously the fish in the start for a certain size, so do you size structure it by size structure in the fish or size structure in the fish?
Can do both. So typically, you don't want to lump animals that have turnover rates of more than about 3 times different from each other. So even if they both ate plankton, I wouldn't lump a fish this big and a fish that gets to this big. So you need to size structure your animals to a point, so you don't want to get too insane. But also the gear. If it's going to target different things, you tend to try and disaggregate that a little bit too, so they can more easily look at differential control. Yeah. So pretty much anywhere you get a purple answer there is an answer that's too big in the pixel. You should also run your eye over some of the others of these, like a production or consumption of 10, that probably doesn't make a lot of sense. Okay, so big fishies that have a plankton-like biomass level, that might be okay. It just depends on what they're. So okay, here jaws has a Z that's more like a plankton than a shark. So you run your eye over to make sure they haven't had a typo, that doesn't really still make sense. So you have to think like an ecologist at this point. So if you're not an ecologist, you have to go find one and see if they piss themselves laughing when they see what you've done. So there's one problem. Okay, so basically what you do then is you take the kind of pedigrees that the sheep was talking about. So I've got a think of a picture in the next one, but basically you say, what's the most uncertain one? So you go through and say, okay, was this sampled in this location, yes or no? Was this sampled from the same sort of reef system or the same area, yes or no? Is it on the same species? Was it on the same continent? Did I just make it up? And then you change your most uncertain ones first and you work backwards to the more sure ones. You can sometimes have to change things to a pretty sure one because it turns out there was a data oops. that it was a, it's not always the mother's fault. It can be because all the time, it's not always. So don't be too afraid to go and ask the data person if they've made a mistake. But like I said before, there's some sort of rules of thumb that you can apply just to run your eye over. So the other part is that you can also, if it's not working, you can try and dig in for why it's not. So there's some diagnostic spreadsheets that help you do this, so they're all built into the program. So in this case, anything that's a green value is telling you, actually, that's a bit odd, that's too high, actually, if this makes sense. So you can say, okay, we have quite a lot of EEs that are too high, but over here, this fishing rate is actually too high. So you can dig into that, and then sort of a gross level. Or you can get into the predation matrix. You can start saying, okay, so the wise aged mermaids are having a problem over here, number four. So number four would be jaws. So jaws is probably said to be eating too many mermaids. So you can start to target where the problem is. Another rule of thumb, the reason it's highlighted all of those along the diagonal there, is you shouldn't have more than about 10% cannibalism. Now there will be some species on Earth where they do have more than 10% cannibalism. So it's not really completely forbidden. But most animals on the planet don't eat 10% of their own population during their feeding. And if they do, you get yourself in a really tight loop that just doesn't make ecological sense. It makes mathematical sense. It doesn't make ecological sense. You have to be wary of those. And this is the pedigree I was talking about. You can actually, so in this case, the more red, the better the data was rated to be. You can define what they are. We'll play around with this a little bit this afternoon. But you can go through and say where the most uncertain data is. So in my case, you can, I just use that as a guide to what to change. In the older versions, there used to be like a Bayesian fitting method that would go through a Markov process of trying alternative fits to see how likely your fit was compared to all fits. I'm not sure that's implemented in the latest version, but it's certainly something they're working on to make sure it comes to the new version pretty fast. Some of the other tools that are in EcoPath is just sort of communication and network analysis tools. So this is just a press a button that tells you what the food web looks like that you've got in the model and actually the relative biomasses. So you can see that your mermaid babies make up a lot of the biomass compared to jellyfish, for instance, in that example. You can also have some of the classical network analysis kind of stuff that's been a bedrock of ecology for 30 odd years. You can get that spat out. Helps you to try and compare between different systems, for instance. And that's all on EcoPath. So before I get into EcoSim, is there any questions that you haven't already asked on EcoPath? You will get to play a little more stuff, and it's more exciting than a rain exam. But I think it's more exciting to want to speak, say something about medical.
But could you go back to please the value you introduce your basic parameters?
For the basic parameters? Scenario. So you have, if you can imagine a Rubik's Cube with the dimensions of uncertainty, you'll have one for productivity of the system, one for vulnerability or how fast things will recover, one access, that's the degree of, say, climate change or...